Working with Safari on your iPhone can be super frustrating and super complicated if you don't know your way around. But after today's video, you're gonna know how to use mobile Safari like a pro. My name's Dylan Stewart, they call me the MacWhisperer. And in today's video, I'm gonna give you my top 7 power user tips to get the most out of mobile Safari. So let's not waste any time. Let's jump right in and get started. Tip number 1 is how to properly use Safari's address bar. A couple of operating systems ago, Apple changed the way the address bar looked on mobile Safari. It had been up at the top of the page, but then they dropped it down to the bottom, and a lot of people got very confused and concerned about it, and Apple eventually gave us a setting so that you could put the address bar back on the top. If you're one of the many people who put the address bar on the top, I'd like you to change it, and I'd like to show you why. The address bar being dropped down to the bottom was helpful for a number of things. First off, your address bar is at the bottom, right where your thumb is when you're holding your phone, so you don't have to reach around and have a really difficult time getting to it. It's easy to tap it to go to a specific website if you want to, but even better than that, you can swipe on the address bar to go to previous pages you've had open. So if you know about the tab button in the lower right-hand corner, which we're going to talk about quite a bit, tapping on it brings up all of your open tabs, and you can click on anything that way. But from the address bar, you can swipe through them even easier, making it super simple to get to exactly the tab that you want to work on. And the second tip with the address bar has to do with creating a new page. If you want to create a new web page on Safari, one of the ways you may need to do it is either taking the page you're on and changing it, which is fine, click down here, type where you want to go, etc., or clicking on the little tab button in the bottom right here, and then clicking the plus button in the lower left corner there to create a new page, which is fine, except there's an easier way to do it, simply by swiping on the address bar at the bottom from your front page. If I swipe to the left, instant new tab, super easy to get to, super easy to utilize. When you first step over onto that new page, you're going to be on what's called your start page. Tip number 2 is customizing and utilizing your start page. When we create a new page or open up a new tab in Safari, it looks like this, and it's got all of this clutter and junk and stuff that you may not know anything about. Up at the top, it's got your favorites. This is where all of your bookmarks show up so you can easily and quickly jump to any web page without having to hunt around for it. Below that, you've got frequently visited, which is the websites you go to the most, or shared with you, which are web links that people sent to you via email or via text. They get saved and collected right here, even telling you who sent them to you. Down below that, you've got cloud tabs, which allows you to open up any tab that's open on Safari on any of your other devices, wherever they are. So this is my computer, this is my iPad, and I can easily pop open any of the pages that are on those devices. There's also Siri suggestions and a reading list. But the most important part is down here, down at the bottom where it says edit, because this is where you get to customize your start page. Up at the top, you can choose whether your start page on the phone is the same as your other devices. If you want them different, turn off that button right there. And here, you get to decide what sections you want in your start page. I don't care so much about frequently visited, and I don't care so much about the shared with you section, but I use cloud tabs all the time, so I want to put that up at the top, and I don't care about Siri suggestions so much either, so I can turn that off. In addition to being able to turn things on and off, by grabbing the bars on the right side, you can move these into any position to really customize that start page. Go down just a little bit further and you can give your start page a background image. You can see they've given you a number of preset background images, but if you don't like what they've got, you can simply click here on the plus button and go directly into your photo library and pull up any page that you want. I've got all of my wallpapers organized here, so let's go and grab one that we like, something not too busy. Let's grab that sand dune there. And then when I close out of it, that's the style that my start page adopts. Tip number 3 is all about learning how to manage your tabs. Tabs are super important on Safari. To To understand tabs a little bit better, we're gonna click on the tab button on the bottom right corner here. Every time you click on a link or open a web page on your phone, it opens a new tab. It does this so that you don't lose any of the pages you've previously got in case you weren't done with them. It just adds a new tab on. But the problem with that is over time, you're gonna have hundreds and hundreds of tabs of things you haven't looked at or used in months or years even. A lot of people worry about the battery life of their iPhone, and so they have a tendency of coming into the multitasking bar here and just rapidly quitting every single app they've ever opened, thinking that's going to save them batteries. But the exact same people don't ever close out tabs on Safari, which uses way more battery than all of the apps on your phone being open at the same time. So it's important to clear out these tabs. Again, you can quickly get to your tabs by clicking on the tab button in the bottom right corner here, and all your tabs are there, all in one long scroll. When you want to close a tab because you're not using it anymore, you can click the little X in the upper right corner of any of these windows, like this. But you can also close a window by swiping it off the screen to the left, like this, which is way easier and way faster to do. But there's even a better way to do it than that, because I'm going to click Done here first. If you press and hold on the tab button in the bottom right, you can close all of your tabs at the same time, which just completely clears out your Safari and starts you from scratch. But if you've got hundreds and hundreds of tabs open, that's going to save you battery, and it's easy to do. Now, there is one additional setting that I want to talk about before we finish up with this tabs tip. And for that, I'm going to swipe up and go directly into settings. From settings, I'm going to scroll down and get myself to Safari settings, which are right here. And I'm going to scroll down to the bottom here, and I want you to see the close tabs setting right here. If you want, you can have it automatically close your tabs after a day, a week, or a month. If you have a habit of just gathering hundreds and hundreds of tabs, this is a great setting for you because it will automatically close off anything you haven't used in over a month, a week, or a day. For most people, I think the over a month setting is the right one to use. Tip number four is related to tabs, but it's something called tab groups. On your computer, most people have hundreds and hundreds of tabs open on their browsers all the time. They think nothing of having 50 tabs open because they're going to get to it at some point. Sure you are. The reality is the more tabs you have open, the slower your computer and your browser run, and the less likely you're going to get caught up with all of those open tabs. Which is where Apple's created something called tab groups, and I love tab groups. It makes a huge difference to keeping things organized. Tab groups are a great way to take a bunch of tabs and a bunch of websites that are related to a project you're working on or something that you're in the middle of and clump them all together. To see tab groups, long press on the tab button on the bottom right. Up at the top, you'll see this little icon here. This represents your tab groups. And in my case, I'm in the middle of looking for a video editor, so you can see a tab group for video editors. I've been doing a bunch of research on different AI apps, so there's my AI research page. And I also love to do escape rooms, so there's a bunch of cool escape rooms in my area, all in the escape rooms tab group. By clicking on any one of these tab groups, you can scroll through the open tabs you've got easily, either by swiping on the address bar or by pressing the tab button here and finding the ones that you want. This means that I can save all of those escape room ideas in one place, all of those date night ideas in one place, and I don't have to leave my browser open all the time, and I don't have to worry about quitting my browser or losing those tabs because tab groups are saved for as long as you need them. Now, for clarity, tab groups are not the same as bookmarks. You really shouldn't be thinking of tab groups like bookmarks. Bookmarks are bookmarks. Go bookmark a page. But if there's a project you're in the middle of, a bunch of tabs that you've got open, maybe you're looking for a new shirt and you've got all these different sales tabs open, or maybe you're looking for a date night idea and you've got all these date night websites open, by having them in a tab group, they're easy to get to, they're already organized. I'm gonna click on our tab button here, and down at the bottom, you're gonna see each of my tab groups, and all I have to do to close one out is press and hold on it, and I can delete it right from there, or I can rename it. Adding something into a tab group is also really easy. Just come to the web page that you're working on, press and hold on any page, and you'll get the option to move it to a tab group. You can even create a new tab group right there to save it easily. So rather than leaving all those tabs all over the place and having 15 windows and 500 tabs open, put them in tab groups together so that they're organized. And in that way, you can have your video editing tabs in one place, and your Burning Man tabs in one place, and your work in progress tabs in one place, and not have to worry about, oops, I closed my browser and all of those tabs are gone. Tip number 5 is about how to get to a specific web page quickly. Now, there may be certain pages that you go to even on a daily basis. And sure, you can click on the little bookmark icon here and open them up from your favorites list. Or you can go ahead and open up a start page and grab it from the favorites here. But if this is a website that you're going to again and again and again and again, make your life easier. Come to that web page and click on the share button at the bottom. From here, scroll down to where it says add to home screen. What that's going to do is it's going to take that website and actually add it like an app directly to your homepage so that anytime you need it, all you have to do is click on it and it will jump you right to that web page. Do this only for websites that you're going to super frequently or can get a little bit cluttered. But if there's one or two websites that you check every single day, making them into a simple app on your homepage is the quickest way to get into those websites. All right, tip number 6 and tip number 7 are related to each other. Sometimes you're on a web page and maybe it's got an article or a story or even a recipe and you want to read and look through it, but it's got all this gobbledygook and junk. It's got ads, it's got pop-ups. It's really hard to see what you're trying to get to. There's something called reader view. And the reader view is only available on specific sites. So if you don't see it, it's not something wrong with you. It's the website you're on. It only works on specific websites. In this case, I want to read this article, but I don't want to look at all of these ads around it. So to get to the reader view, you're going to click on the little and big A on the left side of your address bar. Just tap them, and it pulls up a whole bunch of awesome options, one of which is show reader. And when you click on the reader view, it just gives you the text and the basic images, none of the ads, none of the gobbledygook, making it super simple for you to read that article without getting distracted. But sometimes you don't really want to read it yourself. Wouldn't it be better if your phone would just read it to you? If a web page has a reader mode, it's also got a read it to me mode. Click on the little and big A again, and you'll see listen to page right on this screen. Clicking it will read the article directly to you just like this.
Apple CEO Cook compares Vision Pro launch to previous major launches in new memo, Friday, February 2nd, 2020.
And that's a super easy way to read an article from your phone without all of the complications, all of the ads, and without even having to grab your reading glasses. Now, in a moment, I'm going to share a bonus tip for you that I know is going to make a huge difference for how you work on Safari and other apps on the iPhone. But before I do, if you got good value and learned something new from this video, give it a thumbs up so that other people can easily find it. And if there's something I left out or a question you've got, drop into the comments section and let me know. I love to hear from you. And if you haven't subscribed to my channel yet, now's a great time to do it. I've got all sorts of new videos that are beginning to come out right now, and I would hate for you to miss any of them. And with that being said, let's jump into the MacWhisperer power tip. So I've got a confession. This power tip is not only related to Safari. It actually has to do with the phone as a whole. I'm going to show it off to you by going into the settings section, but we can see it in lots of places on the phone. If you've ever been on the iPhone and you see this little arrow in the upper left corner that's your back arrow, you know it can be really hard to hit that tiny arrow. You've just got to hit it perfectly. It's super small. But Apple never expected you to actually press the button. What the button is doing is it's showing you that the entire left side of your iPhone can be swiped on to go back. So all you have to do is put your finger at the far left side and swipe to the right, and you can go back without clicking that arrow. So what does that have to do with Safari? Let's hop in and let me show you. You know, when you're on a web page and you want to get back to the prior page, there's this tiny little back button in the lower left-hand corner. But you don't need to click that either. If you swipe from the left side of your screen, just like I showed you a moment ago, it will actually allow you to go back to the prior web page and the prior web page from that. In fact, you can also go forward by swiping from the right side. So easily, just by swiping from the side of your screen, you don't ever need to hunt for that tiny little arrow and try to click it with your bat fingers. So that's what I've got for today's mobile Safari tips. 8 amazing tips that will change how you use this app forever. My name's Dylan Stewart. They call me the Mac Whisperer, and it's my passion and profession to help you get more done with your Apple products than you ever thought possible. With that being said, I'll see you next time.